I began my work in albinism originally working with mice. And the question was, why are there so many different colored mice? I found that mutations in that same gene are the cause of the most common form of albinism in people, which we call oculocutaneous albinism type 2, or OCA2. This is the type of albinism that's most common in Africa and among peoples of African origin. We estimate that about 1 in 1,400 individuals in Tanzania has albinism. This is very high compared to the statistics we have for the human population in general, which is about 1 in 20,000 for all forms of albinism. Indeed, the specific form of albinism that's very common in Tanzania that we see in this 1 in 1,400 individuals, worldwide, that form of albinism is present about 1 in 40,000. That form of albinism is what we call recessive. If you have two good copies of that gene, you can make normal amounts of pigment. If you have only one good copy of that gene, you can still make normal amounts of pigment and you don't have albinism. That's the carrier state. However, if you have two copies of the gene that do not function, as we see in people with albinism, there's no ability to make melanin. And so those people have albinism. One of the interesting features that we found when we're trying to better understand why albinism is so common in Tanzania is we've developed a hypothesis that carriers for that form of albinism have a resistance to some sort of infection. This we call balanced selection, such that the carriers have an advantage, but people with albinism obviously don't have an advantage in Africa in particular. So what is that potential advantage that these 1 in 19 people in Tanzania have over other folks that are not carriers? In Tanzania, it's present about 1 in 1,400 individuals. In parts of Sulawesi in Indonesia, among the Minahasan people, for example, we estimate that about 1 in 600 people have albinism. In Panama, San Blas Islands, where the Kuna people live, we've actually found albinism present at an extremely high frequency, close to 1 in 100 in among the Kuna people. For me, the responsibility doesn't end with knowing what the gene is or even knowing what medication might help these people. The responsibility is to ensure that all human beings, regardless of their genetics, are afforded the same rights as any other person.